My name is Alex. I will be talking to you today about blockchain trends and use cases. A little bit about myself. I'm a PM with 8 years of experience in software development and infrastructure projects. And a blockchain enthusiast. I was introduced. I found out about blockchain during the 2017 bull market. I'm sure some of you are in the space longer than me, or maybe similar. And it was crazy times. And I just got interested in the decentralized cryptocurrencies first, and then later on into blockchain technology itself. I'm mentioning before we start to talk about use cases, I wanted to mention cryptocurrencies because it's the most popular use case for the blockchain technology, but it's not the only one. And as majority of you know by now, should know by now, that crypto is based on blockchain, but blockchain is not the only. The blockchain is not crypto. Blockchain has more use cases. And the fintech industry is kind of one of the biggest one. It's a revolution within money system and the tokenization of assets and distributed authority. The reason I'm talking about crypto is because of the bubble that happened in 2017. And some of you that follow cryptocurrencies closely can see, maybe you invested or maybe you're just checking out the space. This happened during the arrow is basically shows what happened in 2017. And there were a lot of new projects in this space. There were basically thousands of them. And you may be familiar with this website called CoinMarketCap. You cannot see there because something is throws shadow on it, but on top of it, it shows the amount of projects currently placed on the CoinMarketCap, and it was 2,000 plus. And in reality, there were a lot more, and not every project made it to CoinMarketCap. It was so easy to create an ICO, and basically, the same thing happened during 2000, during dot-com bubble. Every company that had a blockchain in its name or wanted to to start a business around blockchain and distributed technology, they kind of skyrocketed, get a lot of crowdfunding, and there were a lot of promises to deliver, like change industries forever, implement new technologies and such. And this was kind of a funny gif, what happened during the 2017. Every day we had a lot of new partnership announcement, a lot of new partnership with real world companies. And people were forming in, which is the fear of missing out, and a lot of investing in the space. And of course, everybody was here for technology, as you can see on this slide. But in reality, people did not understand what they're exactly buying, because as it turns out, not everything is supposed to be on the blockchain. And in 2018, there was a harsh reality. And on this slide, you can see that there was a major drop. Some of the currencies lost 95+% of their value because it simply was not sustainable. There were too many projects that were absolutely did not need to be on the blockchain. The centralized system worked just fine, and people who did not have experience in this industry just decided to start the project because of the crowdfunding and funds they could receive. So, and therefore, I wanted to talk to you about the use cases for the blockchain technology and where should we start. Every IT system starts with architecture. It could be microservices. Or I'm not a technical guy, so I will look at this. It could be service-oriented microservices, microservices architecture. It could be the process could be agile or DevOps. And then we have a persistency layer, which is basically databases layer. Databases, once again, there are databases that, such as NoSQL, object relational service brokers, and such. They all need to have the same features to be considered as a good ones. Basically, they need to be available. Data integrity should be intact. They should be durable. And transactional integrity should be applied. This is the layer where blockchain should be applied because it has all these features. And blockchain is basically another version of database. And the platform, it also the services could be run on different platforms, such as serverless or virtual machines. In case of blockchain, they are serverless. And this is important because every 10 years, approximately, we have the same cycle. The IT architectures change, and we are introduced in a new kind of model. At the moment, we are cloud-oriented in cloud-oriented space. We have a microservices architecture style. The development process is agile, and we have in-memory databases and streaming. And we already know what the next thing, what the future will bring. The next databases. The next architecture will be React driven. It will be lean, and as a storage, as a databases, we will use blockchain. But we will not use blockchain for every example, because blockchain is only a specific database that is uses, instead of traditional CRUD, create, read, update, delete model, you can create and you cannot basically delete and update things on the blockchain because you have guaranteed immutability to the that you cannot edit information on the block on a blockchain, and because with traditional databases we have issues because we don't know exactly where data is coming from. We don't know if someone tried to edit it edited it before, and we are not sure if it's have not been tampered with. And also, modern databases do not allow immediate synchronicity. In case of blockchain, it does on the redundancy level. Sorry, I'm not a very technical person. I knew how to tell these things, but I'm a bit nervous and kind of forgot some of it. So we also have, in case of traditional message-based data system, we ask the server for information and expect a reply. Then we can ask if the data received is correct or not. And these are procedures of the present time. When we move to the blockchain distributed persistence level, basically everybody has the same access to the same data without disclosing unnecessary amount of secrets, people can still work on the data that is hashed, not hashed, but is, how they said, hidden, I guess. And there are several use cases that that can be applied specifically for blockchain. Basically, we have four questions we need to ask the business before we can consider a blockchain. Do we have a value in sharing data? Because if several companies access the same environment and have value in sharing the data in this environment, if we answer yes to this question, we have multiple companies that involved in the same process, because if we have only one company, the probably centralized solution will be much faster and cheaper to implement, and it's already a lot of them on the market. And if there is a mistrust between the parties, so basically the companies have used third-party services to sign contracts and pay fees for that, blockchain can assist in accelerating the process and accelerating the process of getting the claims if something goes wrong. And if those parties will be able to agree on the rules for sharing access, basically those companies willing to cooperate in the same environment. If four of these questions are answered yes, companies should definitely consider implementing blockchain technology, otherwise traditional systems work just fine. So far we have already 10 fundamental capabilities of blockchain that work very well, that are proven that work better than traditional technology. It's basically asset tokenization, part of the slide, when identities and assets can be tokenized. For example, expensive apartment could be put on the blockchain, and you can prove that the that you own the part of this apartment or even the whole apartment, and you are the only one who keeps the private key and can prove it. Shared ledger works the same for the. It leaves immutable data trail for services. For example, you can verify certificates issued by certain universities, and other examples that you can see on the slide. And also the smart contract part of it, that you can basically automate some processes within company. You can send. You can automate the processes by signing smart contracts, and you can also claim rights to physical or digital assets using them. Companies that used to implement blockchain technologies, they have similar set of requirements for the technology. They all want to reduce cost, mitigate the risk, and reimagine the process. By reducing cost, blockchain works fine, because by reducing cost, we mean that we remove the third party. We can sign contracts directly between two entities with the smart contract, without need to use lawyers, for example, if it's repetitive contracts. We can mitigate risk. That blockchain works just fine, because it's basically very hard to hack the blockchain database, because it's on a ledger. The hacker needs to hack a lot of machines at the same time, which is very hard to do. And reimagine the process. It's a little bit harder to explain, but basically some companies want to implement within their supply chain a blockchain, such as Nestle. They want to track every manufacturer and every manufactured goods during the process, and later on they can accelerate the claims if contract is breached, or they can basically track and trace whatever happens with their with the goods during the process. For a long time, blockchain technology was mainly the used in fintech, such as cryptocurrencies and tokenized assets. But more and more businesses are looking into how they can implement blockchain into their process, what can be improved. And as you can see, like civilian governments, manufacturing, and retail consumer goods are becoming the first kind of second adapters of the blockchain technology. I will be telling a little bit more about the use cases and the civilian government case that really caught my attention. Some examples of use cases that I found on the web. Basically, as mentioned, one of the apartment on Manhattan in New York was tokenized, and it's a really interesting use case because basically once this apartment tokenized, you can add liquidity, you can remove barrier of enter, so basically people can buy 1% of this apartment and receive monthly percentage for the rent fees that this apartment is rented. And it also increases operational efficiency. And people overseas can actually buy this property on the internet without unnecessary paperwork. Hard to say if it will catch on, but this is kind of interesting use case. It can be used not only for apartments, but for lands, for the art, for whatever expensive goods you can think of. And also, interesting case is blockchain supported elections. There was a case in 2018 that Sierra Leone wanted to implement blockchain to do the elections. Basically, they wanted to add possibility to check if your vote is counted correctly. In third world counties, where there is a big mistrust to the government and the election process, blockchain is kind of useful in this case. And imagine if you can, for example, vote for somebody, and if you have doubts later on, you can check if your vote is counted correctly. For me personally, it's a very good case. So, question is where we are today. We already know what is it and how can we use distributed ledger technologies or blockchain. What value can it bring? And we already know that it can scale, maybe on the second layer solutions, but still. And at the moment, we are at the stage where companies from various industries think, how can they transform their industries and market and implement blockchain technology? What value can it bring to their specific cases? And of course, later on will come when blockchain matures. Someone can think of some killer app and create another industries and markets for the blockchain. Thank you.
Are there any questions to Alexandre? Okay.
So quick question about the different types of architectures. I'm not familiar with the last one on like the 2020 side, like the event-driven architecture. Could you explain what that is?
1 second, maybe I will plug it in again. For the 2020 side, for the 2020 year, we are moving to reactive event-driven architecture style, lean development process, which means that these cycles are a little bit accelerating at the moment, and we have a huge issues with security for current databases, because we set up perimeters across the solutions, but they're occasionally hacked. And blockchain technology is much harder to hack, therefore it's kind of an obvious choice for certain industries like fintech. Sorry, if you can repeat the question, because I kind of...
The architecture style goes from microservices to the reactive event-driven style. But I don't know what the reactive event-driven style is, so I was wondering if you could explain that.
No, sir, I have not researched in the specifics. It's just that this is kind of a new thing. I have not read about more of it. But what I think is just, it's basically when event happens, you have to react very fast, and this approach is kind of, you know, you adapt very quickly to it.
Right. Thank you.
So for microservices, for example, you run the server, and whenever request comes, this microservices is giving the reply. For reactive event-driven, for example, Google Cloud Functions, the function is like a small container. So whenever something happens on your website, for example, you have an order in a web shop, then you just trigger one function. This function starts as an event and returns some value, and that's it. There's no server that is running 24/7 waiting for something to happen. Yes, but it's also event-driven.
I believe that this is like the next step when it comes to microservices. So it's adding like a business awareness to the microservices so they are not stupid, and event-driven means event-driven is taken from the whole event sourcing idea, so that the system is built tiny bit different. It actually does what it did in the past, but apart from doing the actions, it actually stores the events as well, and that actually allows you to do some additional work in the future having the data you collected in the past. But I don't want to elaborate much at this moment, and I'm happy to talk about it like later on.
Cool, thank you. There was one more question in the back, I think.
Yes, it's like less technical, more like operations. I wanted to ask about the case of the Manhattan apartment. And I can imagine how the Happy Path works, like the revenue stream comes in and then we pay out to the owners. But liability-wise, how does it look like? For example, we can't rent the apartment. Who's going to pay the rent for the house, like for the manager of the building? Who's going to pay for that? Do you going to chase Ethereum addresses? I think not. And the other question is more difficult case. Let's say that due to some mismanagement, something happened, like I broke my leg on improperly designed stairs. Who can I sue? No. Because that states, people will sue you.
Those are definitely very interesting questions. And in case of this apartment, the blockchain technology needs to work closely with the government. They need to make sure that this is legal, right? Because they need to have some procedure in place that says that this apartment belongs to whoever holds the token. So in case of, for example, the person who is hired to manage the apartment cannot rent it, I assume that the money could be the money for the keeping the apartment could be withdrawn from token holders, percentage wise. For example, how much they hold, and they should be, because the assets are divisible, so they can lose the percentage which will be sold, and from the money that people receive, they will pay for the how do you say it, for the rent. So everybody lose this similar share, and this money will go to keep the apartment going, for example.
Okay, is it how you would solve it, or?
No, it's just a thing how I think about it, because I have not read into the specifics. It's just the idea that how would I solve, yeah, how would I solve this?
Okay, thanks.
And the second one is the second about broken leg. I don't think it's much different from the apartment that we can have and have one owner. Our owner will not be probably responsible for the broken leg, I guess.
Oh yes, you are. Like, for example, you want to remove like snow from your driveway, but the driveway is public because it's like part of the sidewalk, and then I slept, and you are liable for that even in Poland.
Well, once again, if the traditional case, owner would pay for the broken leg, so in this case, just token holders for this apartment will pay for the broken leg, and it could be, for example, automatically they can automatically lose part of the share, percentage wise, and from that money they can pay for the damage done. It just comes to my mind. Maybe it will be solved something different, because it has to be legal at the end of the day. So government has said this is okay. This is how we will do it, right?
Cool. Thanks.
Thank you. Yep.
Okay, please give a round of applause for Alex. And now we need 2 more minutes for technical stuff, and we're gonna go with the lightning talk from Agnieszka.